exactly in the 20 minutes. Can you hear me? Yeah. Our next speaker will be Bruno de Banst from Ghent University in Belgium. He will be talking about the legal transitions regarding workplace accidents in the Western industrializing world. And he has studied both history, law, and criminology. And in 2010, he defended his PhD on the juridification of workplace accidents in Belgium. Mm-hmm. And the floor is yours.
Thank you, Miriam. So I will talk today about the legal transitions regarding workplace accidents in the Western industrializing world. And I would like to start with this very beautiful lithograph. Lithograph, I don't know how you pronounce it in English, but this litho made around the 1850s. And what you see depicted is actually a nightly scene of the iron mill of Coquerel-Sambre. So Belgium, for you to know, was the second country after Great Britain to industrialize. And this is actually, so from the 1850s, one litho out of a whole series of depictions of this progress of industrialization. Of course, industrialization, you all know what it is. It has to do with a larger scale operation, with mechanization, with use of steam power, etc. But what interested me the most in this industrialization process are actually the negative consequences. So actually the industrial workplace accident as a consequence of this process of industrialization. Workplace accidents themselves are, of course, from old times. But in the 19th century, we see this industrial workplace accident emerge. What is this, then this industrial workplace accident? Well, it has a number of characteristics which are linked to industrialization itself. So it's a serial event, and it has to do with this mechanization, with this use of steam power, etc. You get specific workplace accidents as a consequence of that. One illustration of this is a survey conducted by two Belgian physicians, Maresca and Heyman, in the period 1843 till 1845 in the Ghent textile industry. And actually, they investigated this textile industry to investigate the problem of child labor. But when they were busy studying that, they actually saw the huge amount of workplace accidents which got this serial character. And my point of interest is actually the legal consequences of these industrial workplace accidents. Because, as Simitis, a German scholar, already pointed out in 1987, where, therefore, the industrialization process begins, there is no alternative to juridification. So industrialization leads to juridification. Some examples here are the early child labor regulation that pops up in a number of countries, not in Belgium, but, for example, France, Great Britain, etc. Also, a specific safety regulation and inspection in these sectors of the industrial revolution, being regulation and inspection regarding steam engines, specific regulation for the mines, for the railroads, etc., in order to avoid these catastrophes. Another example of legal consequences of this industrialization are actually a number of criminal and civil trials that occurred response to these industrial workplace accidents. I give two examples. One is from the 1830s and 40s, where the construction of railroads in Great Britain led to a number of trials for the coroner court. This has been studied by Elizabeth Cotton not that recent study, meanwhile, but an interesting study that actually studies these cases before the coroner courts following railroad accidents in the construction of railroads. Another example is from the 1850s, where we see in France that the numerous textile workplace accidents led to a number of criminal and civil trials before the French judiciary. So these are just a number of examples from these criminal and civil trials. When we then study these criminal and civil trials, we see that there were actually, in all these countries where they occurred, there were a number of procedural difficulties. When we look at the common law countries, we see that laborers prosecuting their employers were actually confronted with the so-called unholy trinity. What was this unholy trinity? Well, This was three rules of common law that made it very difficult for laborers to get compensation from their employers. There was the rule of contributory negligence that stated that if a laborer was even 1% responsible himself or herself for the accident, then the employer was not liable. The fellow servant rule stated that if the accident was caused by a fellow servant, well, then you had to sue him and not the employer. And thirdly, the assumption of risk. If you can't stand the heat, stay out of the kitchen. So workers that started working in dangerous industry actually accepted this danger, so they could not just start suing their employer when an accident occurred. This is the common law. But when we look, for example, in Germany, we see exactly not the same difficulties, but also difficulties occur, because Germany at that time, mid-19th century, knew a very formal system of proof. So the laborers had to deliver really according to the very specific formal rules the proof, otherwise their claim was rejected. And when you look at France and Belgium, where the civil code of Napoleon was in force, then we see that, again, laborers were confronted with a number of difficulties to deliver the proof that an accident had happened. For example, a steam engine explodes. How can you prove that this is the fault of the employer? It's very difficult, because how can you prove that? It's very technical. It's very hard to prove. And even in other cases, when fellow employees saw that something had gone wrong, you had to convince them that they would testify against their employer. So you see basically a lot of difficulties in these trials. Interestingly, we see that in the second half of the 19th century, a number of remedies occur against these difficulties. Just to give them as examples, in Germany in 1871, we get the Reichshaftpflichtgesetz that made it easier for workers to deliver the proof. In Great Britain in 1880, we have the Employers' Liability Act that also made it easier, that actually abolished this unholy trinity. And in Belgium and France, we see not a legislative legislative change, but we see a development of case law and jurisprudence that made it also easier for the workers to sue their employers. I give here one example of this Belgian lawyer, Saint-Telet, who in 1884 came up with a new theory that actually implied a reversement of proof, being that the employer had to deliver the proof that he had done everything to make sure that the accident didn't happen. But okay, his theory was rejected by the judiciary, so it had not that much impact. But still, you see that there was some response to these difficulties. In each case, each of these remedies that occurred were all of them insufficient, because only in a number of cases they could help the worker. Sometimes a workplace accident was an act of God. It was nobody's fault, so then who can you blame? Nobody. In other cases, it was the fault of the employee himself, the laborer himself, so he was only himself to blame. So in a number of cases, the laborers stayed behind with empty hands. So that's why in 1884, Bismarck came up with a specific regulation, the Unfallversicherungsgesetz in Germany, that introduced a state-organized system of insurances. So each time when a workplace accident occurred in a specific sector, there was a system of compensation for this laborer, this way helping all the victims of workplace accidents. Interestingly enough, this had a huge impact abroad. When we look a bit around, I'll give you a few examples, then we see that this new innovative German legislation is being studied in the first place in a number of labor commissions. So I give here just the examples of Sweden, Denmark, Norway, Belgium, and Finland, but there were more, where in labor commissions they were studying this system of insurances, each then leading to certain reports with certain recommendations for the government. We then see in the following years that throughout the Western industrializing world, that certain innovative legislation is being voted, and we can distinguish two models. First of all, there is the German obligatory model, First of all, Germany, of course, but also Austria, Norway, Finland, Italy, Holland, introducing this state-organized obligatory system of insurances. On the other hand, you had the French model, which was not obligatory but facultative. Employers had to compensate their workers, but they could do this through voluntary insurances, making contracts with insurance companies, etc., not through an obligatory state-organized system. But anyway, these are the two main systems that occurred. If I talk about all these countries, of course, these are national developments, similar national developments, but still national developments. But at the end of the 19th century, we also see that there is an international inspiration. This international inspiration starts in 1889, when in the shadow of the World Exhibition in Paris, for the first time, an international conference on workplace accidents was organized. So the French were, since 1880, studying the problem of workplace accidents, and they said, well, we have this international conference, an international exhibition, why don't we organize a conference with the topic of workplace accidents? So they did. And it turned out a huge success. So there were many participants, over 700, and actually they were very thrilled with the aspect of finding each other, like the specialists from numerous countries. And they said, we should continue this because it's interesting to see each other, to exchange ideas, etc. So they installed a permanent committee, Comité Permanent, and this permanent committee had a number of tasks. First of all, it had to organize new workplace accident conferences, and it had to publish a bulletin, a journal, a review, containing all kind of relevant information regarding workplace accidents. And indeed, we see in the following years that each 2-3 years, workplace accident conferences were held in a number of countries. Now, the question is, what is now the importance of this international organization, as you can call it? Well, first of all, I consider it an international labor organization avant la lettre. You know that the International Labor Organization is founded after the First World War. But this international organization, private international organization, already started this international cooperation that made it, after the First World War, very plausible to have this ILO. That's the first important. Although there were a number of differences, it was private, while the ILO was public, and it was also non-binding. So they didn't give recommendations or binding recommendations. They only studied it and had some conclusions, but not binding. But secondly, I think it's very important because of the concept of epistemic communities. If we look at epistemic communities, this is a term that has been used in the study of the ILO. Here you get the definition. Epistemic communities are networks of professionals that exercise an authoritative claim to policy-relevant knowledge because of their expertise and competence within a particular domain. Okay, let's look at it. First of all, networks of professionals with expertise and competence within a particular domain. Well, nobody can argue that the topic of workplace accidents and social insurances is a certain particular domain where you have experts in the matter. Just to sum up, you have lawyers specialized in this matter, politicians, administrations, physicians, all interested in this in several aspects of workplace accidents and social insurances. Secondly, the network aspect, network of professionals. Well, we can see on the international level that there is the permanent committee, a number of people working together on this topic, that there are conferences where these people meet, that there is the bulletin where these specialists publish, etc. On the national level, you can say you have epistemic communities in the Labour Commission, for example, in national departments of the International Legation, etc. So this first aspect is certainly true. Secondly, that exercise an authoritative claim to policy-relevant knowledge. That's also the case. I've been studying these conference reports and this bulletin, and actually I found some traces of the inspiration that this, of the influence that these conferences had on national developments. For example, en Espagne, so in Spain, la semence du congrès des accidents du travail et des assurances sociales qui eut lieu à Paris l'an 1889 a porté ses fruits. So they say, in Spain, because of this international conference in Paris, the national developments in Spain happened, occurred. So they started discussing workplace accidents and social insurances after the conference in Paris. Another example in Sweden, there is some testimony where they say that after the return of the delegation of the 1891 conference, that they started a new commission to develop new proposals. So that's a second example. And a third one in Luxembourg, they started to study this problematic after the 1897 Brussels conference. So you see that there is some inspiration from these international conferences in countries where they were not yet discussing or not yet, they were not very developed, these discussions. Interesting is also that there is a constant interaction between the national and the international level, because on the national experts, they go to this international conference, they meet each other, and the other way around, they come back inspired from these international conferences. Perfect. So, if we see between 1889 and 1914, it's a long period, it's 25 years, we see that there is an expansion of this international organization. There is, first of all, an expansion as regard to the content. It starts in 1889 with workplace accidents, very specific topic, but soon this starts developing in the direction of social insurances in general. This implies sickness, unemployment, old age, so all the risks that there are and that are covered nowadays by the social security, so the welfare state. Secondly, there is also expansion in the sense that they are actually spreading the social insurance idea. It starts in the Western industrializing world, but you see that this idea is actively spread by the people from this international organization to the rest of the Western industrializing world. First of all, the United States. There are Americans present at the international conferences, and they also become active in this matter. But also South America, Eastern Europe, etc. So following this process of industrialization, we get this judification where this international organization plays an active role. Also, nationally, they try to expand the idea of social insurance, because we see from 1908 on that they actively promote the constitution of the founding of national departments of this international organization, which are then local epistemic communities in the sense that they gather all the specialists regarding this topic. And they actually interact in the sense that the international organizations ask the help of these national departments to do all kind of things. Then I come to my conclusion. First of all, if we talk about industrial workplace accidents, then we see that there are similar legal transitions in the Western industrializing world. I only gave some examples, but you see that despite the different legal cultures, the different national systems, that there are similar evolutions in all the countries of the Western industrializing world. Secondly, we see that these legal transitions from 1889 on are actively stimulated by an international epistemic community which interacted with national epistemic communities. I thank you for your attention.